Now.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Democracy Now!'s Nermeen Sheikh.
Thank you, Amy. And welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. Defiant Occupy Wall Street protesters streamed into Zuccotti Park late Tuesday in a bid to rebuild their cause less than 24 hours after police forcibly removed them from their camp. A fired-up crowd of several hundred joined in the first General Assembly since the surprise eviction. The eviction had occurred around 1 a.m., with hundreds of police storming the camp and dismantling tents, tarpaulins, outdoor furniture, mattresses, and signs. They arrested over 200 people, including about a dozen who had chained themselves to each other and to trees. Even as protesters returned Tuesday evening, they were banned from bringing backpacks, tents, and sleeping bags with them. A judge ruled yesterday afternoon that the city had the right to enforce rules against camping gear in the park. Justice Michael Stolman found the city, at least for now, can ban the protesters from pitching tents and unrolling sleeping bags in the park. Democracy Now! Was at Occupy Wall Street last night to talk to some of the protesters as they regrouped after the raid.
The fact that the police have done this, have dismantled it, and I mean, the video, they're just throwing stuff. They're just throwing people's possessions. And you know, like, there's a Borders that used to be down there. If we had gone down there and thrown all their books out, and then we had gone to, like, a camping store and thrown all their tents out, there would be hell to pay.
Yeah.
But I think that people are starting to look at that because this has such a psychic hold, because it's such a big symbol at this point, whether anybody wants it to be or not. It's causing a lot of attention, and that's good. And hopefully, at that point, we can start the conversation again and we can say, like, all right, no tents, what's the alternative? And ultimately, that was a conversation that needed to happen anyway.
Please tell me!
Please tell me!
Why everyone in this park, has a solution!
Has a solution!
We kind of needed to reevaluate where we stand as a movement, and I think this is a wonderful opportunity for us to grow and to strengthen from it. And I think we've been ultra within the law, and like we've always played by their rules, and now that they've thrown this at us, it's just good that we get a chance to show how intuitive and how ingenious we are as a movement. I can only see growth from here, and I think people have come back not with a vengeance, but with a lot of hope, strength, energy, and just more love for each other. It's caused us to refocus a whole lot, so I'm really grateful for them cleaning the park.
If you look right over here, starting from nothing tonight, we have already received several, maybe a couple hundred books of donations. So, you know, the People's Library is strong. The people are donating and taking the books already within a matter of hours of reopening the park.
We're just passing out food. They don't allow us to have a kitchen anymore inside the park, so we've now set up one just a block down, and we're passing stuff over the fence so that people can get food.
My name is Brian Freud. I'm a physician assistant. Since we lost so much yesterday, we are afraid to lose more. Our resources are limited now. So right now we're making sure that if we need to pack up and leave in a hurry, we can. What we're doing is we make sure we have our emergency necessary supplies in case things get out of hand, people get pepper sprayed. We have solution plus basic essentials, bandages, ice packs, thermal blankets, all the necessary things for bumps, bruises, cuts, sprains, dehydration, and just making sure people take care of themselves.
I'm a student at NYU Law, and at one point I remember we were walking quite slowly, and the group kept saying, slow down, slow down. We're not in a rush to get back there. This is our time, not theirs. And the cops behind them were pushing with their batons and shoving the Lawyers Guild people with their batons, saying, walk faster. The law is you have to walk faster than us, which I'm here to inform them is not, in fact, the law. I come from a very conservative state. I'm from Indiana, and I think I've always been quite respectful of the police. I recognize that they're doing an increasingly difficult job. But I think this experience has shaped the way that I think about the police. It shaped the way that I perceive our government. And honestly, when I first came to law school, I was perfectly content doing corporate work. But after watching this, I just feel increasingly compelled to actually do something with my life to affect change and to just stop, you know, this unnecessary and aggressive and just disgusting and despicable behavior by our government officials and our police officers.
My name is Ray Lewis. I'm a retired police captain from the Philadelphia Police Department. And the reason I'm down here is because I'm tired of seeing suffering of so many people while you have 1% who is accumulating all this wealth on the backs of all the workers. The police are the 99%. Unfortunately, they don't realize it. But what they are basically just enforcing the laws of the dictators, which is the 1%. and they're having their health care cut, their pensions cut, and their salaries reduced, and they don't even realize it.
We are the 99%!
We are the blood of this country!
This country can't live without us!
Let's take control!
One of the huge misconceptions is that, oh, the movement is in this park. Movement's in our head, it's an idea. Like, it's what happens while we're here, you know, the conversations we have that we take with us everywhere. The working groups are still 100% functional, and we have this wonderful thing called the internet. I don't know if the cops have heard about it, but they can't shut that down.
They could try.
They could try, but, like, you know, we still have access to the ideas we have, and we still have the ability and the opportunity to share the ideas we have.
Voices from Occupy Wall Street, less than 24 hours after police forcibly evicted protesters from Zuccotti Park. During a news conference yesterday, New York Mayor Michael Bloomberg defended the early morning eviction of Occupy Wall Street protesters.
The First Amendment gives every New Yorker the right to speak out, but it does not give anyone the right to sleep in a park or otherwise take it over to the exclusion of others. Nor does it permit anyone in our society to live outside the law. There is no ambiguity in the law here. The First Amendment protects speech. It does not protect the use of tents and sleeping bags to take over a public space.
Mayor Michael Bloomberg. For more on Wall Street and similar movements around the nation and the world, we're joined in New York by two guests. When we come back from break, we'll talk to Marina Citron, who's just returned from Greece, and Jeff Charlotte, who's one of the organizers of Occupy Writers. Back in a minute.
Freedom, freedom, freedom. Freedom, 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 freedom. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Long way from my home, yeah, yeah, Lord. Singing freedom, 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 freedom.
Richie Havens at Woodstock in 1969. Well, for more on Occupy Wall Street and similar movements around the country and the world, we are joined by two people. Here in New York City, Maria Citron is with us, postdoctoral fellow at the Center for Globalization and Social Change at the City University of New York, author of Horizontalism, Voices of Popular Power in Argentina. She's researching global mass movements from Spain to Egypt and has just come back from Greece. We're also joined by Jeff Charlotte, contributing editor for Harper's Magazine and Rolling Stone, also the author of a number of books, including the bestseller The Family, and most recently, Sweet Heaven, When I Die. Jeff Charlotte is an assistant professor of English at Dartmouth College. His most recent article for Rolling Stone is called Inside Occupy Wall Street, How a Bunch of Anarchists and Radicals with Nothing but Sleeping Bags Launched a Nationwide Movement. He is also one of the founders of Occupy Writers. We welcome you both to Democracy Now. Jeff, okay, how did this group of what you say are anarchists and radicals have launched a nationwide movement?
Well, I should say that that is the judgment of my editor at Rolling Stone and his wise judgment who chose the subtitle. But, you know, in fact, it was actually sort of talking to Marina that I got a lot of insight into the early origins of this movement, which I wasn't there for, you know, and especially those meetings, I think, that you would really go back to in August. And one of the things that I found most fascinating was a woman named Marissa Holmes, who I think has been on the show before, and said, you know, at those early meetings, a lot of the traditional left groups walked out, and they weren't there, and it left artists and media makers and writers and people who just were sort of thinking in terms of imagination rather than kind of very strict, you know, policy 10-point programs. And I think that's key to what happened, is that imagination.
Occupy writers, what are they?
Occupy writers are late to the party, as writers usually are, and it grew out of precisely that sort of feeling, like, why aren't seeing musicians and artists down in Zuccotti Park, why aren't writers here? And some were, of course. I kept thinking, you know, at least someone will start a letter and I'll sign that, and no one did. So it's really through Twitter, and I don't know Salman Rushdie, but I saw he's on Twitter, and one night I said, would you care to sign a letter if we had such a thing? And he wrote back immediately with ideas and names and so on, and from there it took on its own life, and now it's 2,000 writers in support of the occupations, but they're also going down there with their bodies, bringing books, and writing new works, new poems from Alice Walker, Bemini Snicket, the children's writer. Writers famous and not famous, and that's key, because the idea was to democratize literary culture, not reproduce one of those sort of, you know, sometimes sort of snooty pen letters that has, you know, just big names. Anyone can sign this letter, and you'll be on there next to 5 U.S. Poet Laureates. But your book about the vegan zombie revolution, which is an interesting title, it's on a list, will be right there in there as well.
And the Occupy Wall Street Library had something like over 5,000 books, but a number of them, if not all of them, were either confiscated or discarded in the raid day before yesterday. And now apparently there's an attempt to reconstruct the library or reclaim it in some way.
It's already happening. It was happening last night, you know, as I understand it, Democracy Now! Had the sort of the seed volume in that Brave New World that Amy found there. And but when I was there last night, it was sort of growing. I mean, when I left at 3 a.m., it was up to about 100 volumes, and there was another box off-site. Now, they might be able to get the original collection back, which the city has been sort of cagey about. You know, it's released a photograph of about 200 books, said they couldn't release them because there was needles amongst them. You know, this kind of sort of silliness. Even if they don't get them
and
back.
And the tent, the shelter for the books, which was provided
was
by the National Book Award winner, rocker, Patti Smith.
Yeah, and that was destroyed. You know, this institution, this creative, and, you know, it's important to recognize that was the library for that part of the city. There's not a library very close by there. Even, you know, one of the protesters you quoted saying, talking about, you know, going into borders. Not even Borders is there anymore. So you would see just families from the area bringing their kids to get children's books. They might not be involved in the protest, but this was no longer even a parallel institution. The main institutions had failed so completely. This was the institution.
Marina Citron, I just want to ask you what you think. You've just come back from Greece. You're familiar with movements elsewhere. Given the raid day before yesterday night on Occupy Wall Street in New York, what do you think the trajectory of the movement should be now? How should they deal with this?
Yeah, I mean, these raids we've been seeing across the United States and around the world, similarly, as the movements grow and grow in the plazas and the squares, the police come in and repress, and it doesn't deter the movements. And, you know, similarly, as in Greece, where I just was, I think the movements here will start to go more into neighborhoods, which we've already started to see happening. So continuing to occupy a plaza or a park that's really significant and symbolic, but then also, for example, in Athens, there are many, many neighborhood assemblies now dealing with local issues.
It's interesting you should say that, because last night at the General Assembly, which was remarkable to see, I mean, well over 1,000 people, and it went on for hours at Occupy Wall Street. One of the people in the stack, you know, they're just sort of making announcements, and the stack is what they call it, got up and said, occupy your block.
Exactly. I mean, that's exactly. And they're actually finding in Greece, for example, that by being more community-based, local-based, they can address specific needs more. So, for example, electricity is being taxed. So they're working on making sure people don't have their electricity cut off, preventing people from being evicted from their homes. So similarly, in Harlem, people have been working with Occupy Harlem and preventing people's heat from getting cut off. In Occupy Bronx, it's about preventing people from getting expelled from their homes. So more and more kind of re-territorializing, but at the same time, keeping a space where we can have our assemblies and exchange experiences from around the city. And I think, actually, it's a much more radical, if not revolutionary, way of organizing. Because when we just come to one plaza, we come to a plaza and have a gathering related to that space. When we're in our neighborhoods and we come together and relate in that way, it's more like alternative governance, which is, I think, what we're seeing to a small extent in Greece now, and in Spain as well, similarly.
You've talked a lot about the horizontal nature of these movements. Can you explain a little bit what exactly that means and what some of the disadvantages might be mm-hmm. of organizing in that way?
The horizontal nature, and this is something that people are speaking about all over the world, and the word horizontal as well. So when I was in Greece, I was with someone from Argentina from the social movements, and they started talking about horizontalidad after their crisis in 2001. So horizontal is relating to one another in, you know, this flat way, and people say not in this way, not.
So in other words, not hierarchical, but
not hierarchical. Equal, not yeah. usually using the language of hierarchical, but meaning we don't want to have power over each other. Let's think of a way of thinking differently about social relationships and creating power with one another. Which doesn't mean there's not sometimes leadership or people with different experiences, but it's not having power over one another. Some of the challenges to that can be. People come in and we're not heard in our society. We don't have a real democracy, and that's true globally. So people want to talk and want to talk a lot. And so we have to think about structures to make sure everyone's voice actually does get heard, which is why we have facilitation groups and different structures for these assemblies so that everyone can get heard as equally as possible.
And yet, Jeff, another of the speakers last night at the General Assembly said, as everyone talks about moving out from Zuccotti Park, from Liberty Plaza. I guess sort of the idea is you can take us out of liberty, but you can't take liberty out of us. One young man made the point that was repeated over with the people's mic and over. Let's also keep this plaza because otherwise the police win. They see it as a very strong symbol. The world sees it as a symbol. It's a place the world can come to, and so we shouldn't let it go.
Yeah, I think that's a feeling. That's why there was people there through the night. And remember, they couldn't lie down. They couldn't have sleeping bags. Sort of people walking and trying to catch a few bits of sleep while they're leaning against a tree or something like that. And they were there throughout the night. And it didn't take a huge number though to keep occupying it. Just a few people still maintains that space. But the one thing, with complete respect for that individual, unless the police won, my personal feeling is that that's not as important whether or not the police won. And I think, that was the thing you saw at that General Assembly last night. It was this day of great police violence and brutality, the rule of law completely forgotten. And the dominant emotion was not anger. It was happiness. That was one of the happiest General Assemblies I had witnessed. It was joy. And so there wasn't so much of that, squaring off with the cops. It was, we are creating our own thing here.
And there's also a difference in who's in charge now. Now, while there were a number of police, and especially as you walked away from the plaza, there were many, many police vehicles actually surrounding the General Assembly and Zuccotti Park last night was Brookfield Properties security. It's now corporate security that is standing there. Not clear exactly where they come from, but the mayor's made very clear now they are in charge.
Well, when you talk to those guys, that was interesting, too. You had guys who were ex-military. You had a lot of guys whose experience was as bouncers. There's that popular thing. The police are 99% as well. Those guys are really—they don't have any of the police protection, any of the pension, the union, all that kind of stuff that police have. And they were sort of one by one. There was, the angry guys, but there was a lot more of them who did not feel like doing this job. And you saw that breakdown. They'd been ordered to sort of search bags as people came in, and they just stopped doing it. And, so there was just that kind of nice sort of on-the-job resistance to even what they were being ordered to do.
So, Marina, you don't have any—just to turn back to an issue that you brought up earlier, that if Zuccotti Park, people can't stay there overnight any longer, and if the movement disperses to neighborhood assemblies, that somehow it'll become more diffuse because of the lack of, physical solidarity.
I think not at all. I think absolutely people are starting to organize more in neighborhoods. At CUNY on the 17th, there's going to be a massive action. In workplaces, people are talking about different kinds of actions, but still coming together.
Columbia University last night as well as Occupy Columbia.
Yeah. So both schools, workplaces, neighborhoods, but then, yes, coming together as well, just like in Athens. Learning from the experiences in Athens, it was both going to the neighborhoods, but then coming back to Stigma Square and having assemblies of assemblies. So we had gatherings. I participated in gatherings from many different neighborhoods coming together to share experiences, learn from the Argentine experience, talk about New York. So in New York and all over the U.S., if we're more in our neighborhoods, but then we also do come together, we have to, whether it's in general assemblies or spokes councils or whatever directly democratic form, to reflect on our experiences and generalize out, I think that's actually more powerful. But yes, holding Liberty Plaza has become so important to people around the world. When I travel around the world, talk to friends in Argentina, everyone says, you're in the heart of the empire. Hold it. So whether we sleep there or not, I don't know that that's as significant, but that we have assemblies there, that we continue to make it a space that's actually public, not the Brookfield property, private park, whatever that even means. But we continue to open spaces and make them more public spaces and commons for people, I think, is what's most important.
That actually is interesting, whatever that means. They say it is a public park that is owned privately. I wonder, has anyone asked them to produce the note? You know, the whole idea with foreclosures that you ask the bank to produce the note and how often it was found. In fact, if you trace it back, no one actually has the actual documentation of who's in charge.
Let's foreclose on Brookfield,
Talking about the different Occupy movements, among those supporting the Occupy California movement in Berkeley is Pentagon Papers whistleblower Dan Ellsberg. He spoke to Democracy Now! Correspondent John Hamilton last night about how he's pitched a tent on the Mario Savio Memorial steps at Sproul Hall at UC Berkeley. Last night, Robert Reich spoke, winning the Mario Savio Award, and he was addressing thousands. Yes, UC Berkeley, the birthplace of the free speech movement.
I'm Dan Ellsberg. I've been arrested a few times before, but I've never seen a scene like this. Hard to believe that the police will try to shut this off, but we'll be standing here to see if it happens. Some people are kind enough to bring me into one of their tents on Mario Savio steps here in front of Sproul Hall. So I'm really honored to be with them.
And Daniel Ellsberg, you'll be staying here tonight on the steps of Sproul Plaza?
Staying here tonight. When I heard the people had voted, by the way, I've never seen a group process like the General Assembly tonight. They were voting, thousands of people here. It was an inspiring sight. I wouldn't have thought it could happen. And I'm very pleased. It takes me back to the Rocky Flats Truth Force on the tracks. That was a place where we had a chance to sit on those tracks because they didn't take us off except when the train was coming with nuclear material from Rocky Flats plutonium production facility. So we could have a continuous action. And we were able to stop the trains every time they came around for a year. Well, I haven't seen anything like that since that was 1978. But this Occupy movement is an invention. Tempted to say it started here, but actually it came right from Egypt, and that's from Tunisia. And actually, an inspiring thought to me is that the man who's accused of putting out the State Department cables to WikiLeaks, Bradley Manning, who's sitting in Leavenworth right now, one of his cables, in fact, several of his cables, was a major inspiration to the uprising, the nonviolent uprising in Tunisia. So one person can make, speaking out, can really make a very big difference. And of course, Tunisia led directly to Tahrir Square and the occupation. But I think the inspiration for all of these movements in America and around the world. Frankly, it's been a while since I felt as much hope as I feel tonight. I've almost been reluctant to speak in public and let people know how hopeless I felt it sometimes. And that mood has changed tonight. I don't think it'll go away. And the young people are recreating the youth movement of the 60s. And the youth movement changed this country in the 60s. And we haven't seen it really like this since then. So I have great, great hopes for what's coming out of this.
Now, Daniel Ellsberg, you are, of course, well known for being the person who leaked the Pentagon Papers. And you are a defender, therefore, of the right to free speech and the right to publish in this country, freedom of the press. We certainly saw the University of California last week lash out against students who were trying to express their opinions here on campus. Your thoughts about the behavior of the University of California towards the attempts of students to occupy their university?
You know, I think the point that Mario Savio made so long ago was that an institution like this, and like the executive branch of the United States, and the police, and the Berkeley police, really can't help themselves when it comes to being confronted with dissent like this. They're their instinct to repress it is just irrepressible. You know, a new device of repression in this country in the last 10 years has been the zone of dissent at conventions and other places. The police mark off a particular street or put people behind a cage somewhere, you know, or behind fences. Say, you have your dissent here. Well, this is our zone of dissent here, and we're going to stand in it. That tent where I'm spending the night is a very nice zone of dissent, one that I'm proud to be in, and I'm not feeling constrained at all.
Pentagon Papers whistleblower Daniel Ellsberg helped to end the war in Vietnam, along with a major movement, as he released the Pentagon Papers, the secret history of U.S. involvement of the war in Vietnam. Hear me?
Marina, can you talk a little bit, as we've just seen this clip from Occupy Cal, about how it is that different Occupy movements across the U.S. and globally are working together now?
It's wonderful. I mean, the positives of globalization is how much we're meeting each other around the world. So when I was in Greece with someone from Argentina, there were other people there who were from Egypt, who are exchanging experiences and really concretely talking about, okay, well, in Argentina, how did you take over workplaces? How are they still horizontal? What does that look like? How do you keep your electricity on when the government tries to cut it off? And similarly, throughout the United States, I've been meeting people from all over who come to Occupy Wall Street. In Spain, there are people from Portugal. In France, there are people from London. And so people are really exchanging concrete experiences, in particular, on both what they're creating, the forms we're using for democracy, but also how to relate to the state.
And do you see these movements succeeding, for example, in Greece, where Greece stands right now?
I do, actually. I mean, it depends how you define success and what the goals are of the movements. So most of these movements are not saying we want to take over the government right now. It's we want to create alternatives and create better lives for ourselves to create kind of the seeds of that alternative that we will be in the future. And I do see that happening. Yeah.
Do you see the resignations of the heads of state of Italy and Greece as a kind of victory for the
protesters? I think it's because of the movements. But when I was in Greece, it was not the conversation. The conversation was about the neighborhoods and about real democracy. It was actually less about the government.
Jeff Charlotte, as all of these movements are taking place around the United States, you also have the Republican presidential campaign playing out with every week, it seems at least, a presidential debate. You wrote C Street. You wrote The Family. Talk about the Christian right. Talk about Tea Party activism in relation to what we're seeing now with the Occupy movement and what's happening?
The Christian right and Tea Party are sort of two different things, and the Tea Party is already sort of dissipating. It just didn't. It wasn't true that it was just AstroTurf. It really was a social movement, but they were eager to be co-opted. They were knocking on the door of the Koch brothers and saying, "Give us money," and that's what happened to them. The Christian right is a bigger, broader social movement that grew really—I mean, you can, wherever you date its beginning—that grew up in large measure in response to movements like Occupy Wall Street of the past. This sort of real fear of a kind of direct democracy of people taking things into their own hands and forgetting about the invisible hand of God and the market. You know, free market fundamentalism. And they're still there. And I think we don't see them very much right now. But as much as we get excited about this, I think we should understand that there is another big, broad, powerful, and genuine social movement in America and internationally that's as globalized in many ways. You know, Christian right activists say, you know, we're teaming up with our allies in Ukraine and Nigeria and Uganda and so on. I don't want to present it as, you know, now these two duke it out. But they're there, and what that means for the future, I think, is hard to say.
And what does it mean for Republican presidential politics? You had Texas Governor Rick Perry almost launching his presidential campaign at a prayer meeting.
Yeah, Perry's, you know, he's sort of like George Bush's belief as a kind of sort of default practical setting for Texas politics. It wasn't very deep and wasn't very aware, and he picked all the wrong characters. So nobody sort of wanted to say it at the time that, you know, you line yourself with an outfit like the American Family Association, where people have actually, you know, endorsed or practically endorsed the killing of gay folks. You're really outside of even the mainstream of the Christian right. And so it didn't go. I mean, none of these candidates really have the ability to seize onto the Christian right. And my guess is that they will sit out this election in a way that they haven't in a long time.
And the effect on Democratic presidential politics, the Occupy movement?
Well, the Occupy, you know, I'm sort of with Marina like that. I think, you know, you spend enough time in the park, I think people don't care.
But the effect it's having at the highest levels, I think they, to say the least, care what this means, because they're raising the very issues that make the Democratic Party as vulnerable as the Republican Party, the capturing of these parties by Wall Street and by the banks.
Yeah, absolutely. But the Democratic Party is just not in a position to respond to that. If anything, the Democratic Party right now is in a position to respond more to Christian rights. So we see, you know, characters like Heath Shuler, who's very, very conservative Democratic congressman from North Carolina, is very prominent now in all these sort of budget negotiations, who lives at the C Street House run by the family.
And explain the C Street House.
The C Street House is a house run by the sort of oldest and arguably most influential Christian conservative political organization in Washington, where they provide subsidized housing for congressmen. I mean, it's beyond ethics. It's beyond good and evil. But so there's a number of these, you know, these Democrats just can't turn. They can't respond to the Occupy Wall Street movement. They haven't been able to in decades to respond to something like that. I think you might actually more surprisingly see the rise of more of these conservative family values Democrats.
Well, I want to thank you both for being with us. Jeff Charlotte has written a number of books. He also is contributing editor for Harper's Magazine and Rolling Stone. His latest piece is in Rolling Stone. It's called Inside Occupy Wall Street. And Marina Citrin, postdoctoral fellow at the Center for Globalization and Social Change at City University of New York, author of Horizontalism, Voices of Popular Power in Argentina. In fact, at the stack as well, a young CUNY student from Hunter, that City University of New York, stood up and said, don't forget, November 21st, we want people to walk with us, with the students. In addition to what's happening on the second month anniversary of Occupy Wall Street here in New York on Thursday, when major protests are expected. We'll be back in a minute talking about the new military urbanism, cities under siege. Stay with us. Beast by Supremo for all of my people, Negroes and Latinos, and even the gringos. Yo, check it, one for Charlie Hustle, two for Steady Rock, three for the forthcoming live future shot. It's five dimensions, six senses, seven firmaments of heaven to hell, 8 million stories to tell, nine planets faithfully keep an orbit with the probable tenth. The universe expands length, the body of my text possess extra strength, power lifted powerless, up out of this towering inferno. My ink so hot it burned through the journal. I'm blacker than midnight on Broadway and Myrtle. Hip hop past all your tall social hurdles, like the nationwide pride, this prison industry complex. Working class poor, better keep your alarm set. Streets too loud to ever hear freedom ring. Say it back in with your sleep. It's dangerous to dream, but your chain cats can think you're back. You dead now. Killing fields need blood. Mathematics by Mostef here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Chick.
Before dawn on Monday morning, hundreds of police and riot gear raided the Occupy Oakland encampment in order to evict peaceful protesters. It was the second time the police had evicted protesters. A similar raid was conducted on October 25th. On Monday, more than 30 people who chose to remain as an act of civil disobedience were arrested. Later in the day, Mayor Gene Kwan's chief legal advisor resigned over what he called the, quote, tragically unnecessary police raid.
I visited the campment on Sunday prior to the raid. It was a peaceful Sunday morning. One of the people who happened to be right in front of Oakland City Hall at the Occupy Oakland encampment talked about why he was there.
Hi, my name is Ali. How y'all doing?
Hi. Have you been here from the beginning?
Pretty much.
And what do you want to see happen here?
Well, there's a lot of things. You know, I'm from Oakland. You know what I'm saying? So that, for me, these changes is not a Wall Street thing, it's not a bank thing, but it's a social thing. You know what I'm saying? Everything that's been going on in Oakland, the homicides, schools being closed down, libraries being shut down, teachers being cut off, public workers getting laid off, work furloughs, everything that the city is supposed to be taking care of us on is not being done. You know, that's what I'm here for, is trying to get them to start taking care of us as a people in Oakland, California. I mean, this is minute. You know, this is a small thing right now if we look at it from Oakland's perspective, okay? But this is not small. We are a role model for the whole world, and that's what's going on.
And how are the police dealing with this at this point?
Can I be frank? I don't care. But I want to say it in different words, you know, but I don't care. You know, what the police think. I don't care what Mayor Kwan think. I don't think what any politician think about what we're doing here, because what we're doing here is starting something new. You know what I'm saying? I don't deal with any type of politics situations or none of that. What I'm dealing with is this encampment of Oscar Grant Plaza, okay? That's the only thing. That's the only my concern.
And why is it called Oscar Grant Plaza?
I mean, you know, it's a representation of what's been going on in Oakland, California for a long time with the oppression of poverty here, of the people of the community of Oakland, okay? Oscar Grant was a young male who was pretty much handcuffed on a bar train with a 250-pound officer on his back, 6'4", okay, while he had another officer on his neck, and the officer pretty much pulled a gun and shot him in the back while he was still in handcuffs, laying down on the platform on his stomach. So how I don't understand the threat in that, okay? And that's the threat of these corporations on our society and our community. It represents that. We are all on handcuffs. We are all on our back. We have no way of getting out of it. And they pretty much have got these guns on our back, and they're shooting us. It's a representation of a whole.
And what do you think this encampment has accomplished? How long has it been out here?
I mean, you know, this encampment has accomplished a lot. Okay, for myself, like, you know, we have discussions all the time. You know what I'm saying? And it comes to what society labels us as. You know, and this right here, this encampment, has given the people a chance to change what those labels are. You know what I'm saying? Whether you've been called a black man who's a criminal, or Hispanic who's a car thief, or an individual who's a racist, this is a place where none of that exists, okay? Because if you come with those, that you're going to have some type of change, okay? And we're pretty much what I've seen happen here, because of this is our own world, our own community, our own society that's by the people, we feed people. Okay, we house people, okay? Not just people, but families as well. You know what I'm saying? These people, if you go around West Oakland, the homeless encampments all across West Oakland are pretty much here. They are a part of the society, and they have to be recognized that they are here. You know what I'm saying? But everybody here is not a homeless individual. Some of us are hardworking class. You got these homeless people, crack addicts, heroin addicts, disabled people, right along with the same people that are doctors, lawyers, practitioners, chiropractors, teachers. We're all here together. Okay? We are parents. We are mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters. Everything here is together. No matter what label you put on us, you know, I'm a criminal, I'm a thug, I'm a convict, I'm a gangster, I'm a womanizer. But you know what? That's what society labeled me as. This society, I'm not none of those. I just met these people right here. You know, I've just met you guys. Do you guys consider me as a thug or a criminal or anything?
No.
There we go. You know what I'm saying? And that's what's been going on in society, is that we have these labels upon ourselves, living in these low-income areas, and pretty much, like I was saying, is that we need to start showing the people.
That was Ali at Occupy Oakland on Sunday morning. Within 24 hours, the encampment was raided, scores of people arrested. Oakland Mayor Jean Kwan admitted in an interview with the BBC that she and leaders across various cities around the country experiencing Occupy protests, well, participated in a conference call.
I was recently on a conference call of 18 cities across the country who had the same situation, where we had started as a political movement and a political encampment, ended up being an encampment that was no longer in control of the people who started them. And what I think you're starting to see is that the Occupy movement is looking for more stability. There's been a lot of last week talking to peaceful demonstrators, ones who wanted to separate themselves in my city away from the anarchist groups who had been looking for a confrontation with the police.
Well, as police forces violently crack down on protesters across the United States and Europe, we turn now to an author who looks at the increasing influence of military technology on domestic police forces. Stephen Graham is professor of cities and society at Newcastle University in the UK. His book, Cities Under Siege, The New Military Urbanism, looks at the links between military counterinsurgency tactics deployed in war zones abroad and the methods of surveillance and control increasingly used in urban areas around the world. Stephen Graham, welcome to Democracy Now! Could you say a little bit about what the significance of your findings in the book were regarding the Occupy movements in the U.S. Particularly?
Yes, well, the book really tries to look at the ways in which police forces are increasingly using sort of military ideas and military tactics at the domestic scale to confront particularly mobilizations in cities, such as the Occupy movements that we're talking about here, and how those tactics and ideas and increasingly technologies have really close links through big security industrial complexes to the moves in the military towards a really intense focus on cities and on counterinsurgency tactics in sort of war zone cities such as Baghdad and Kabul.
Right. In a CNN article that appeared yesterday, the author talks to a police officer who reports that now the kind of equipment that's accessible to the police includes machine guns, tasers, and also that larger and mid-sized police departments in the U.S. now have access to tanks. Can you say something about how this happened?
Well, there's been a long-standing shift in North America and Europe towards paramilitarized policing using helicopter-style systems, using infrared sensing, using really, really heavy militarized weaponry. That's been long-standing, fueled by the war on drugs and other sort of explicit campaigns. But more recently, there's been a big push since the end of the Cold War by the big defense and security and IT companies to sell things like video surveillance systems, things like geographic mapping systems, and even more recently, drone systems that have been used in the assassination raids in Afghanistan and in Pakistan and elsewhere as a sort of domestic policing technology. It's basically a really big booming market, particularly in a world where surveillance and security is being integrated into buildings, into cities, into transport systems on the back of the war on terror.
And then talk about the issue of surveillance, whether we're talking about how the Occupy movements are being watched, surveilled, monitored. Very interesting to hear Oakland Mayor Gene Kwan say on the BBC that they're coordinating. And they are coordinating with the FBI, they're coordinating with Homeland Security and dealing with these movements. So talk about the surveillance apparatus, something you know very well from Britain. And name names. What are the corporations involved?
Well, there's a whole variety of corporations linked to university research departments, linked to large-scale data mining companies, linked to companies like Raytheon, who most people know of as making missile systems. Increasingly, they run border surveillance systems for things like the airline security and so on, which is a big thing in Europe and North America. But the key point really here is that surveillance is being used to try and track activist groups, permanently sort of monitoring them using video systems, using database systems, and to allow infiltration. These are very much seen as movements that need to be infiltrated. In the UK, there's been a big scandal because of undercover police going into activist movements across Europe, green movements, social movements, and so on, with a view to sort of basically being informers and spies to allow police to sort of crack down on what is effectively completely legitimate democratic activity.
What do you think the significance is, Stephen Graham, of the fact that protesters across the U.S., and it's been true in Europe as well, are increasingly characterized as somehow criminal, drug addicts or sexual predators or somehow a sanitation or health hazard to the communities in which they're protesting? Can you say a little bit about how this works?
Well, in the book and elsewhere, other authors are writing these things too. I think it's important to put this debate in a bigger context of how cities have changed. And cities in the last 20 or 30 years, particularly in North America, have become much more sanitized, much more controlled by questions of zero tolerance, by questions of really aggressive policing to clear out those that are deemed to be sort of not fitting a model of urban life which is centers on consumption, which centers on business. So there's been a really powerful shift in cities to sort of criminalize homelessness, to criminalize panhandlers, to criminalize those not seen to belong in this what Neil Smith in New York has called the revanchist city, the city taking back spaces for the wealthy, effectively. That was very much Mayor Giuliani's strategy. So in a way, I think what the Occupy movement is so powerful at is demonstrating that by occupying public spaces around the world, and particularly these extremely symbolic public spaces, it's reasserting that the city is the foundation space for democracy. And we have to reassert that symbolically and with the actual groupings of the activists in space. So the internet is not enough. It's very much necessary to reassert that cities are political spaces which need to be used to mobilize social and political change.
And you talk about how the population centers has so dramatically shifted, not only in the United States but around the world, to the cities. And it's that question we'll end with, Stephen Graham.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, last year we moved past the moment where 50% of the world was living in cities. By 2050, 75% of the world's population will be living in cities. But too often, political and military power is controlled by people who see cities purely as threats, purely as sites of unrest, sites that need strong military and security control. And what's so wonderful about the Occupy protests is that there's a different and much more hopeful idea of cities being pushed there in a world where we have a really radical crisis and a radical sense of illegitimacy for the social model that we're all still having to live under.
Stephen Graham, thank you for being with us. His book is called Cities Under Siege, The New Military Urbanism. And that does it for our broadcast. Democracy Now! Is produced by Mike Burke, Renee Feltz, Aaron Mate, Nermeen Sheikh, Steve Martinez, Sam Alkalfani, Masood Ravi, Karen Ryan, Deborah Odina, Guzder, Manal Khan. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.